everyone. This is Dr. Cheryl Selman, and welcome to What Women Must Know, a show empowering you with truthful information so you can make the most informed decisions possible regarding your health and well-being. Thank you for being with me, because I have another really inspiring conversation this week. As always, I have to say we're so blessed to have so many people who just continue to inspire and uplift and help us transform our lives so we can be the very best that we can be. For those who are listening for the very first time, I always like to welcome my new listeners and encourage you to go to my website, which is drcherylselman.com, or my Facebook page, What Women Must Know, because I then can send all the archive shows right to your inbox, or you can just get them on the posting on my Facebook page. So you'll always be sure to listen to all of the great shows I have. And, of course, lots of other goodies come along with that when you opt in to Dr. Cheryl Selman, various articles and information, and lots of good things posted on my Facebook page as well. So I hope you'll join me there. And I think we're just going to jump right into the topic at hand, because it's such a fascinating conversation we're going to be having today. We are exploring the astonishing science of how your brain creates material reality with Dr. Dawson Church. And let me just say a little bit about Dawson. He is an award-winning author whose best-selling book, The Genie in Your Genes, has been hailed by reviewers as a breakthrough in our understanding of the link between emotions and genetics. He founded the National Institute for Integrative Healthcare to study and implement promising evidence-based psychological and medical techniques. His groundbreaking research has been published in prestigious scientific journals. He is the editor of Energy Psychology, Theory, Research, and Treatment, a peer-reviewed professional journal. He shares how to apply the breakthroughs of energy psychology to health and athletic performance through EFT Universe, one of the largest alternative medicine sites on the web. And Dawson's latest book is Mind to Matter, The Astonishing Science of How Your Brain Creates Material Reality. And that's what we're going to be exploring today. So first of all, it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Dawson Church to the show today. Hello, Dawson.
Hey, Cheryl. It's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you. It's been so many years since I've had you on the show. We talked.
I know.
Oh, gosh. Too many years ago. It just flies by. So I'm thrilled to have you back, because, Dawson, you are always such an inspiring person. You have the drive and commitment and passion to really pioneer new avenues and create legitimacy. You know, you're taking these modalities and giving them credibility, creating the journals, making these modalities available. And it takes great determination and the ability to persevere. I mean, I know, you know, it's just hard work, and you're passionate. And thank you, because you are making such a difference in the world.
Well, I'm passionate because these therapies are so effective, and for them not to be available to everyone who walks into a clinic or emergency room or hospital or VA center or veterans hospital is just, you know, every moment that those aren't available, Cheryl, haunts me. And I'm so committed to seeing these amazing therapies available. And to do that, you have to get them into the mainstream. And I love all of our individual practitioners. I train thousands of psychotherapists and coaches and medical professionals every year. But my real focus is on, as you say, making these kinds of new therapies legitimate, because until they're where the people are, they really don't have their full potential unlocked. It's like if people go into a doctor's office and they don't know about EFT tapping, or don't know about meditation, or don't know about grounding, or some of the many other ways in which you can heal, and all they get offered is a pill, then they've only got a tiny fraction of what's available to them. And the more educated people go out and find the information, but for the average Joe just going in there, walking into the hospital, they just don't know these things even exist, and so as a result, they're not getting some absolutely remarkable healing strategies and therapies. So that's what really drives me.
Yeah, I really understand. And I have to say, before we went on air, I had a conversation with you about this, you know, three fractures that I created in my arm and the surgery that I had to have, the emergency surgery that I'm still recovering from. And you reminded me about doing EFT, and I just am very grateful for that reminder. I've been calling upon all the modalities that I'm aware of to accelerate the healing. That's my vision. That's what I hold. I'm going to heal rapidly and completely in record time. And you reminded me about using EFT, and I just want to thank you for that, even though that's not really our focus today. But I want people to know that if you go to the EFTuniverse.com, you have so many resources there, as well as trained professionals who can help people accelerate the healing. And that's what you were explaining to me, that EFT has shown that it can accelerate healing and improving the immune system and just clearing the trauma that allows the body to heal more rapidly. So thank you so much for reminding me about the effectiveness of EFT, and I will follow up on that. So I'm grateful
Good,
to you
yeah.
for
yeah,
adding another
heal
tool.
Rapidly and fully. Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, people who do use it experience huge benefits. Also, the sizes of the effects are enormous. Like, we just had a paper come out in a journal called the Journal of Evidence-Based Integrative Medicine. It was published a couple of months ago, and if you want to look it up on PubMed, you can do that. And PubMed is the U.S. government database of the big journals and what they publish. And people were doing EFT with me for a week, and they were also meditating in the morning. So that's the two-pronged approach that I really recommend, is meditation and EFT. And we found that their psychological markers just shifted a lot in the week. So their anxiety and depression both dropped by about 40%. Their happiness shot up by 31%. And so when the bad stuff goes down, when the stress goes away, all of the beneficial emotions have a chance to rise to the surface. So emotionally, they shifted a lot in that week. But the focus of that particular experiment was not psychology, but physiology. So we're measuring their heart rate, their blood pressure, their heart rate variability, their cortisol, because cortisol is your main stress hormone, and it's a proxy for a whole bunch of other things. I mean, thousands of things happen in your body when cortisol goes up or when it goes down. So it's a proxy, it's the physical proxy for stress. And so we were measuring their cortisol, and we wanted to measure the good stuff as well. So when your cortisol goes down, what goes up? And there are several things you can measure. But we were measuring immunoglobulins, and we found that immunoglobulins are found throughout your mucous membranes. They're in your eyes, they're in your gut, they're in your mouth, they're in your saliva. And what their job is, immunoglobulins are there to capture pathogens and toxins, and they neutralize them. And so if you have a high level of immunoglobulins, your immune system is functioning at peak, you don't get sick. It just is this amazing immunoprotective substance found all the way through your body. And even at this entry point into your body, there are immunoglobulins standing by to make sure the bad stuff can't get in and destroy it when it does. And so you need a high level of this. So we found over the course of that week, Cheryl, that their baseline of cortisol dropped by 37%. And that's a huge drop. That's a massive shift in your basic level of cortisol over the course of the week. But their immunoglobulins, then we knew we'd find a rise in immunoglobulins, but we were just absolutely stunned by the size. And the number was 113%. That is, the cortisol fell 37% over and this is just 1 week. This isn't like, you know, months of training. This is just 1 week of tapping and meditating. Their immunoglobulins rose by 113%, more than a doubling of immune function. And that means you're much less likely to get cold or the flu. Pollen, anything coming in from the outside world doesn't bother you nearly as much. All kinds of beneficial effects. Your stem cell count is usually going to be rising when that happens. Your telomeres are lengthening. All kinds of downstream benefits are happening when your immune system is at peak. So that's the effect that these therapies, these techniques can have on people's lives. And so that's why, again, I want this tie-in to be there, where people aren't just offered a pill, they're also getting the option of energy therapies in primary care. I want to tell you one story, too, before I wrap up, about one of my friends who's coming out with a book about her experiences doing this. And she was diagnosed in March of 2017 with metastasized breast cancer. And she found a lump on her breast, her right breast, and she went into the hospital, and she went into a big famous hospital in Houston called MD Anderson Cancer Clinic, probably one of the top five cancer hospitals in the world. And she also went to other places as well and got several opinions, but the tumor was measured at 2 inches across. And this is a big, big tumor, 5 centimeters across.
Wow.
And
yes, huge.
Huge. And so they then suspected metastasis. So they gave her thermography scans, and they found that all of the lymph nodes under her right armpit near the tumor were all swollen, inflamed, and engorged with blood, indicating that her lymph nodes now had cancer in them. And when cancer gets into your lymph glands, it can just travel all over the body, because it's like your bloodstream. It's like a circulatory system. It just goes all over. They then found 3 spots of inflammation on her right lung. And so when the whole puzzle was finally put together of her diagnosis, and she was sitting in the oncologist's office hearing this, the oncologist said, her name is Beth, she said, "Beth, normally I'd want to schedule you for chemotherapy and radiation as soon as possible. This is so serious, though. I want you to actually leave my office and walk straight to radiology today for your first treatment. It's that life-threatening." And Beth said, to her great credit, she said, "I need time to think and weigh my options." So she got other opinions, and she also immediately, right then in March, began to make radical lifestyle changes. She cleaned up her diet, which was pretty good, but she'd been slipping and having sugar. And so she got rid of all the sugar and eating fresh, high-quality, plant-based food. She got rid of all the stress in her life, and she just literally shut down anything stressful. If she had a social contact or engagement that was stressful, she quit it. She turned off all the alerts on her cell phone. She quit watching the news. She quit listening to any kind of media that was distressing or upsetting. She focused on energy. She phoned me and emailed me one day, and she was really upset because she said, "I've had a gene test, and they found 8 defective genes, some of which predisposed me to breast cancer." And I said, "Beth, you have 24,000 genes, which are perfectly fine. Let's work with those." So
exactly.
We did some surrogate EFT with her. My wife would sit with me, and my wife would say, "My name is Beth," and we'd do some tapping together. So we did surrogate work with her. She got energy medicine treatments. She spent time with a friend of mine who's a Qigong master, and she did Qigong intensively. And she just focused on energy, making her energy as wonderful, as clean, as clear, as bright as possible. So she got the diagnosis in March. In May, she went back to MD Anderson for another set of tests and scans, and the lymph nodes under her right armpit near the tumor were completely clear, not a trace of cancer in them, and the tumor had shrunk from 5 centimeters to 1.4 centimeters. And so, again, the surgeon being a surgeon, the oncologist said, "Well, let's just get you into radiation right away, and let's just do surgery to cut off that shrunken tumor." But another doctor said to her, "You know, that tumor, I think, is necrotic. It's dead. And the body is just busy removing it. That's why it shrunk so much. Let's just let the process happen naturally," which she then did. And this isn't a year later. This is just 2 months later. So she's changed only her energy. That's the big thing she's changed in her life. And she's then seen this huge, huge shift. Later on, of course, the tumor was gone completely, and later blood tests showed no traces of cancer in her body. So that is what is possible with energy healing. And again, that's why Beth happens to be a really well-resourced person. She knows me. She knows a lot of influential people, and she could call us and get really, really high-quality information. Most people walking into a hospital don't have access to best resources. And I think that needs to change, where every woman needs access to the kinds of health care that can really help without some of the treatments that people get have such serious side effects that they get these treatments without any thought to first try energy. So I really want to see that change in our society in the next generation.
Well, that's our goal, is accessing techniques and modalities and healing options that can work on a deep level of bringing balance and energetic balance back into our lives, which is kind of where, you know, the Mind to Matter book, your new book, is to me an extension of the work you've been doing with energy medicine. And it's really a fascinating topic for me, because I have for most of my life had a spiritual yearning and spiritual experiences and on a spiritual path. And it's all about understanding this innate power we are all born with to create a reality, to create a world, to create possibilities that influence the physical, that actually determine the physical, that actually program the physical, which is so backwards to the culture, to the matrix, as I like to call it, that we live in, that tells us it's the other way around, right? So, I mean, I've seen miracles, I've witnessed miracles, I've had miracles of my own happen, and this is the power that we all have, but it's not the education and wisdom that we are taught in schools, you know, and we have to begin a seeker's path to reclaim and reconnect with this immense power that we all are born with.
We do. We have to do it deliberately, and we have to do it systematically, and we also need to do it when we are fine, when there's no crisis, because if you wait till you have a healing crisis or a money crisis or a relationship crisis, then you're just having to do a lot of work to make things, to correct your life. But if you do it proactively every day, then you're going and establishing healthy patterns, and then you're much less likely to get sick or have those crises. So for some of us, it takes, I know for me in my life a few times, I needed a wake-up call, and it's been in the form of a really unpleasant event. But when you learn to do this proactively, and you're meditating every day, and you're tapping whenever you're stressed, and you're spending time in nature, and you're deliberately introducing balance into your life, if you're doing all of these things proactively rather than reactively in response to a crisis, then when you do have life happen, I mean, maybe the economy crashes. It's not going to spare you. When the economy crashes, it crashes for everyone. Or when the wildfires, just thousands of people here in California have lost their homes, and it's not like the wildfire meanders around your house. You might lose your house as well. But whatever the problem is, you are resilient. And in Mind to Matter, like, there are case histories. In Chapter 1, there's a case history I was rereading today that is absolutely stunning. It's of an astrophysicist who is also a TV reporter, and he had heard about meditation's health benefits and thought he might give it a try. He wasn't really a strong believer in that anything would happen, but he thought, well, you know, read about meditation, I'm a TV journalist, and I should see if it has effects on me. So with a whole TV crew, he began an 8-week meditation journey. But the first day, before he got going, the crew went into a university called Monash University, and biological psychologists and others did a comprehensive workup on him, including MRI scans of his brain. They measured every single, there's a term called voxels, little tiny little particles. It's like a three-dimensional map of your brain, extremely high-resolution MRI. And they measured him, and then he began his meditation journey, and he found after just 2 weeks of meditation and mindfulness, he was much calmer, his road rage had gone away, he was kinder to people around him, and his behavior began to change. Then in 8 weeks, he went back into Monash, and they hooked him up to the same machines, gave him an MRI again, measured his brain, and Cheryl, this is the number I give in in chapter one of Mind to Matter. And whenever I say this number, I like to slow down because it's so astonishing. The part of the brain that governs, that is responsible for emotional regulation, there are several pieces to that emotional regulation circuit, but they're coordinated by a network of neurons called the dentate gyrus, which is deep in the midbrain, the limbic system. And they found that his dentate gyrus in 8 weeks, 8 weeks before and after the MRI scans, his dentate gyrus, responsible for emotional regulation, grew by 22.8% in just 2 months. So 22.8% increase in the volume of neural tissue in that dentate gyrus responsible for regulating emotion across multiple brain regions. That's how quickly your brain literally is rewiring itself in response to consciousness. Change your consciousness, tap, meditate, reduce your stress, and it's not just a feel-good thing. So you do feel better, but that feeling better is indicative of profound changes happening in your cells. And in Mind to Matter, that's why the book subtitle is The Astonishing Science of How Your Brain Creates Material Reality. Your brain is literally changing, and as your consciousness shifts, cells, enzymes, neurotransmitters, hormones, all these things are shifting in your life, and that's why Abeth can heal, because her internal biochemistry is radically different. It can no longer host cancer cells, and so she heals. And you can be doing that proactively every day with these techniques, not waiting till there's a health crisis, but just wake up in the morning, meditate. I have a whole bunch of meditations online. They're free. They're about 14, 13 minutes long, not even 15 minutes long, pretty short. But we're showing that when we put people in an MRI, that they're putting people into these profound states of brain regeneration, of hormonal regulation, of neurotransmitter and mood neurotransmitter like serotonin and dopamine are shifting, huge changes. And if you do it proactively, then when you have the problem, the diagnosis or the divorce or the kid who's sick or problematic or whatever it might be, the parent with Alzheimer's, then you are resilient because those circuits like the dentate gyrus have become so much bigger, and you can effectively regulate your emotions and create a much better life for yourself. So that's why I'm such an advocate of people doing these things, not just reactively in response to a crisis, but proactively as part of their everyday life.
And it is improving the quality of one's life. We're all seeking happiness, and it's available to us, but we have to make the changes and support the body's ability to stay in balance and to access these areas of the brain. So let's start with understanding the relationship between consciousness, our physical brain, and how that impacts the body, because I think this is an area where people have a lot of confusion and need to really have a clarity on what, when we say consciousness, when we're focusing on tools like meditation, that is a practice that is activating the brain, but it's not in the brain that it begins. It begins somewhere else. So can you help us understand this whole process and journey?
Yeah, I can. It's a great question, and I can best illustrate it by contrasting the views of materialist science with those of new science, of science, what science now knows about this process. And the old view was that consciousness was an epiphenomenon, this is a fancy word they use for it, an epiphenomenon of complex brains. And simple organisms like an amoeba may have a nucleus with something that resembles some awareness in it, and then as animals evolved, as it became more and more complex, eventually they had bigger and bigger brains, and this threw up this epiphenomenon, this downstream phenomenon called consciousness. But there's no proof, there's no evidence in anywhere in science that that's the way it happened. The way, what science shows, and again, there are over 400 studies on which Mind to Matter is based, so this is a book based on hard empirical science. Hard empirical science shows that we live in information fields, and these information fields are non-local. And so at the very beginning of the book, and at the end again, I talk a lot about non-local mind. When I sit in meditation every morning, Cheryl, I meditate, I calm myself, I do a little bit of tapping first, I sit there and I really, I have a series of seven things I do to get me in the zone. And then you're in this deep flow state. You feel wonderful. But then I can literally feel my awareness drifting upward into that non-local information field. And there's wisdom there. Cheryl, there's also so much love there that often I'm crying at the end of the meditation. I feel so humbled and so overwhelmed by all the love in the field. That information field of the benevolent universe is just full of love. It's just so absolutely overflowing with love. And it just pours into us every day if we slow down, take that 15, 20 minutes, and tune into it. So I feel that coming in. And so the hard data shows that the brain is not generating consciousness, that the brain is a transducer of these fields. There is a great universal consciousness. There's a great wisdom that keeps the solar system spinning and that helps birds migrate from one part of the world to another and helps nature figure out what to do. So nature is, in fact, infused with this consciousness. We human beings can be infused with it, too, if we tune into it deliberately like that. So there are all kinds of epigenetic things happening in our bodies that are the result of this non-local wisdom. And so the brain is like a device that transduces a signal. Like if people are listening to this podcast on a wireless mobile device, they would, of course, associate the sound they're hearing with their wireless mobile device. If they didn't have their wireless mobile device, they wouldn't then be able to listen to this podcast. But that doesn't mean that this podcast is in their wireless mobile device. You and I are not inside that person's iPhone. So that's the analogy of mind to non-local consciousness to brain. The brain is the iPhone. The brain is the device that is encoding this and giving it meaning and projecting it into the outside world. You can hear the broadcast because you have a brain. And so the brain functions in this way. And in a remarkable series of experiments that I outline at the end of the book about consciousness, the researchers took a 30-day reading of the Earth's geomagnetic fluctuations. And the Earth has these fields that fluctuate based on the solar wind. The solar wind rushes past the Earth at about 2 million miles an hour, very, very fast, and it actually plays a little melody on the Earth's magnetic field. And this phenomenon has been studied by NASA extensively, and there's some NASA illustrations in the book showing how, as the solar wind blows by, it interacts with the Earth and creates these resonances. And these resonances turn out to be very similar to the brain waves our own brains create. They're harmonics of each other. And so they, in this really remarkable series of experiments that got going a few years ago, and they're now publishing a whole bunch of science on this, but they took that graph of the fluctuations up and down of the Earth's geomagnetic field, it's called the field line resonances, for 1 month. So it's a 30-day readout, and it looks kind of like any random graph would look, just there are peaks and valleys, it fluctuates every day, there are big spikes, there are big troughs, and then they measured the heart coherence of an individual who is practiced and trained at being in heart coherence, and that coherent individual, the peaks and troughs of their heart coherence map onto the peaks and troughs of these huge galactic cycles that are fluctuating through the universe. And this experiment has now been replicated and is being done with groups of people. And essentially, if you are not a meditator, if you're out of step with nature, if you're not tuning into non-local mind, then you're out of phase. Your heart rate variability does not match these big cycles. But when you come into coherence, then you are, not only are you in coherence with these huge galactic cycles, you're in coherence with every other being and every other consciousness and every other human being who's in phase with them as well. So we're beginning to realize that people who are in coherence, and I also have printouts in the book of what a coherent brain looks like and an incoherent brain looks like. They look very, very different. Manifestors, people who are good at manifestation, they have coherent brainwaves and they have coherent minds. Those that are poor manifestors, they have incoherent or non-coherent brainwaves, and they're very, very different. They don't look the same at all. They're not in phase. So people who are able to be in coherence in this way are literally not only in coherence with the universe, they're in coherence with everyone else who's in coherence with the universe. And so these scientists are now are proposing this as a credible hard science explanation for synchronicity, clairvoyance, telepathy, distant healing. We're part of these huge information fields, and as we become coherent, our brains become better and better and better at translating them into material reality. So the old model of consciousness is an epiphenomenon of complex brains. The new model is that there are these huge information fields, and our local minds can become transducers of them from those non-local fields, and then we see things manifest outside of our bodies. And there are lots of examples in the book of people who got coherent, who did this, and then were able to produce changes outside of themselves. The most interesting way of demonstrating this, I found, is by the effect of coherent minds, coherent brains on water. And when a person in coherence holds their hands over glass of water or a container of water and holds healing intentions and then places those healing intentions consciously into the water changes. And the molecular bond between the hydrogen and oxygen atoms is, of course, one big oxygen and two little hydrogen atoms, H2O. And that bond, that bonding angle is normally 104 degrees. And that number has been known for decades in chemistry, that the angle of bond between that big oxygen and those two little hydrogens is 104 degrees. But after that water has been blessed and had healing intentions infused with it, that bonding angle shrinks to less than that. And when that blessed water is then used to water plants, they grow much faster, much bigger, and have more chlorophyll in them, much healthier than unblessed plants. So our thoughts are literally changing the water molecules of our surroundings if we're in that healing space. So there are lots of examples in the book of this. So that's really what I'm arguing for in the book, is aligning yourself with non-local mind, moving into that kind of elevated consciousness where you're one with those great cycles, and then living a life in which you're one with those cycles. That's why it's not mind over matter, it's mind to matter. So you're part of a much bigger mind, and then your actions are coherently expressing the love, the compassion, the beauty, the wisdom of that non-local mind. You're not trying to control the outside world in the old mind to matter kind of paradigm. You're one with the force that runs the universe, and then when you one with that force in exuberant, blissful joy every day, you tend to then bring those material circumstances into focus in your life because you're literally changing molecules around you all the time.
This is such a powerful wisdom. It's been taught for thousands of years in all spiritual traditions. But it seems like what you are part of, and as we move into understanding this quantum universe that we live in, it's being able to explain it to the rational, materialistic culture that we've created to support people's ability to understand and also then practice. I mean, it's making this wisdom and these tools available to everyone. You don't have to go to a monastery. You don't have to live in an ashram. You don't have to go to the jungles and the Amazon. It's really creating an opportunity for everyone, simply, easily, inexpensively, to shift their consciousness and really realign with their true self, realign with the patterns of the universe that we are an expression of. And out of that, we can create miracles. And I guess this is time, Dawson, isn't it, for the masses to have access to this knowledge, wisdom. You provide all the knowledge that supports this understanding, and then provide the strategies, the techniques, the simple little techniques. If people just give it 15 minutes a day for a month or 2 months, things can change. And you just have to have the discipline and the trust and the faith.
It's a democratization of knowledge that was once available only to a few. One of the interesting things I looked into is how many people throughout history actually cared enough to seek these states. And I won't go into detail into the research that shows this, but essentially, if you look back through history and also in the present day, it's about 1% of the population bothers with this kind of activity historically. And so those people in the Middle Ages, those people in ancient times, biblical times, prehistory, they went somewhere not in the world to practice this. They went to the cloister, they became the desert fathers, they became the medicine women, the curanderos, they left society and they went to a place apart from society where they had initiations, where they practiced really high ceremonies and were able to attain enlightenment or these elevated emotional states. So that was the model back then, is you couldn't do it if you were the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker. You had to go somewhere else and remove yourself from everyday life to find it. What's happened now in the last generation, and very, very recently, is that we're saying you don't have to be a monk in a cloister. You can be a business person, you can be an entrepreneur, you can be an employee, you can be a retired person, you can be a school teacher, and you can find and practice these same elevated states. And what is even more striking to me is that, Cheryl, it's not just that people are doing these in their everyday lives. I have a large project called the Veteran Stress Project, where we've offered free EFT now to over 20,000 veterans over the last 10 years. And we were actually blocked from the VA. And in fact, we were actually banned at one point from the American Psychological Association. So trying to get around those constraints, I started this organization called the Veteran Stress Project with a bunch of therapists to give veterans free EFT outside of those systems. And all of those restraints are now gone. We're now approved by the VA. People get American Psychological Association credit for doing my workshops. All of those bans have crumbled over the last decade. But we're now doing this with veterans, and we're finding that PTSD is curable, that in just 6 EFT sessions, which is what they get in the program, that their nightmares, their flashbacks, their hypervigilance, all of those things, all of those symptoms simply go away. And it only takes 6 one-hour sessions. So now seeing people who are traumatized getting this, like we've done this with the victims of school shootings. We've done this, and their parents, other kids in Newtown, Connecticut, and in Parkland, Florida. We've had volunteer teams go in there and work with people in those communities. We have done this with our volunteers have done this with people in Rwanda who have lived in orphanages for the last 25 years because their parents were killed in the 1994 genocide there. And that's serious PTSD. If you were 3 years old and your parents were hacked to death with machetes before your eyes and you survived, and now you're all these years later, you're 28 years old now, often these people are incapacitated by those symptoms of PTSD. It works with them. It works with people who are traumatized by other kinds of phenomena. So now not only has it gone from the cloister to the office and the workplace, it's gone to the most traumatized people on the planet, and it's working for them. That knowledge, those esoteric energy practices that 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago were known only by the very few. So we're witnessing this democratization of this remarkable knowledge, and I can tell you it's going to completely, radically reshape the entire future of civilization because of the impact of these states on people's lives.
Well, that's a pretty big mission you've taken upon yourself, Dawson. And it is necessary. People are really – suffering because they've disconnected themselves from the power that they have by connecting to a greater field, as we were saying. And it's time that people, through simple but powerful tools, strategies, techniques that you are very much a part of, can find their true power again to create, to heal, to transform their lives in whatever ways they want, to allow them to feel a greater sense of connection to the source of who they are. It's extremely exciting, I think, what you're doing. It's massive. It's a massive shift of consciousness, and that is really what's required to transform the world.
Yes, and we're on that trajectory. My first book that became really popular was The Genie in Your Genes, and there I talked about the epigenetic effects of this. So as our consciousness shifts, as we move from either a balanced state to anger or negative emotions or frustration or upset, that triggers massive genetic shifts. But I'm far more interested in when we move into positive emotional states, when we tap and meditate, what happens. In one study of EFT, the researchers were examining people's gene expression before and after getting an hour of really good EFT deep therapy. And what they found was that in that 1 hour, 72 genes changed in their expression, genes that code for stem cell production, genes that code for telomere length, genes that code for metabolic regulation, genes that code for suppressing cancer tumors, both breast cancer, prostate cancer, throat cancer, colon cancer. All of those cancers were suppressed. Those genes were activated by just 1 hour of EFT. So these kinds of effects are epigenetic. They are producing changes to our genome, and that's why this is so radical. We're just much healthier, much, much happier people. I think not by little increments, not by 3% or 5%, but we're seeing these huge effects in people's psyches. Now, what I write about in Mind to Matter in Chapter 2 is the bigger social implications of this through a field of research called emotional contagion. And the model here is infectious disease, the way the colds or the flu can travel and infect large numbers of people. Emotions are infectious, and people who are negative can affect, like one negative person in an office can infect the whole office with a negative emotionality, but one positive, cheerful person can infect everyone around them with positive emotionality. And these effects are widespread. You saw in big social movements like the rise of the Nazis in Nazi Germany, mass emotional contagion in a negative way behind Adolf Hitler. In the U.S., we saw mass emotional contagion before the Iraq War. There was a huge shift in public opinion from thinking it was nuts to endorsing it. And Congress giving George Bush the War Powers Act. So all of these ways in society, you see society changing. And when you start to do this, you become an agent of positive emotional contagion. And research shows that you then affect the people around you, who in turn affect the people around them. And so three layers out, our taking care of ourselves, us loving ourselves, us healing ourselves, is having a positively emotionally contagious effect on people around us, even through social media. In one study I talk about in Mind to Matter, the researchers were able to produce emotional contagion in over 750,000 people by tweaking their Facebook feeds. They tweaked the Facebook feeds of a few people, and then it was those people infecting others, and those people infecting others. When they finally stopped the experiment because it was getting out of hand, they managed to negatively affect the emotions of 750,000 people. But you can affect the people around you by your positive emotions, and they affect the people around them. So we're at this junction in society now where the world is improving massively in terms of the historical sweep of events. Every single major marker of human well-being, if you look at the last five centuries, is slowly improving, and in some cases quickly improving. And so we're in the middle of this remarkable shift that will mean that I think that, for example, will pretty much wipe out most cases of anxiety, depression, and PTSD before the end of the century, because more and more people are using these tools and techniques. They're realizing that they're possible. They're realizing they can heal. And just the way we wiped out diphtheria, typhoid, typhus, polio, cholera, all of those diseases in the early 20th century, I think we're the same place now for mental health in the 21st century. So we are approaching a very different world.
So, Dawson, what would you say to people who are really concerned, because they look around in our culture, we're seeing vaccines being mandated with no exemptions, we're seeing the rise of technology and 5G with the health implications that are scary. I mean, when people look around and they can feel discouraged, overwhelmed, powerless, what would you say to people who feel that way?
Change your inputs. If you want to change your outputs, if you want to change your emotions, change what you're putting in. If you're reading stuff that's negative and discouraging and fear-laden, I haven't heard a great term. I think I use it in Mind to Matter. Yeah, I do. I use it in Chapter 2 of Mind to Matter. It's called fear porn, like pornography, fear porn. And I was having a picnic with some people. My wife and I go dancing a lot, and we were with this group that does free-form dancing on Sundays called Sweat Your Prayers. And afterwards, we went to all get lunch together after Sweat Your Prayers, and I was at a picnic lunch with this friend of ours. It was a beautiful day, and we were all sitting in this town square and eating our picnic lunch together, hanging out together, beautiful people, just enjoying each other's company. And she was just so afraid of all of the things you're talking about and more. And she listens. She listens to National Public Radio every day, and she reads the newspaper. And she thinks it's getting her informed. And what it's doing is it's getting her afraid. And so there's all this negative stuff you can pay attention to, and scare yourself. Or if you step back and look at history, you'll find again by every objective measure. And there are lots of books about this. Enlightenment Now by Steven Pinker. Factfulness, again, showing how all these measures of human being are improving. And I summarize quite a few of them in Mind to Matter as well. And so if you're going to have a good input, I mean, it's garbage in, garbage out. If you just fill your mind with that negative stuff, then you're going to have a negative emotional experience. If you fill your mind deliberately and consciously with positive stuff, then you are going to have a positive experience. And it's not like it's just a selfish, narcissistic thing that happens for you. You wind up having an effect on the world. If I were just bemoaning how poor the treatments are for PTSD and how benzodiazepines have, one of the drugs used for PTSD, have a terrible effect. They double your chances of getting Alzheimer's. They double your rate of death from any cause. They produce depression, all kinds of horrible side effects. And, if I were just focused on these things are all true, but if I focused on them, then, and I wouldn't have started the Veteran Stress Project, but instead you become wise, you become intelligent in your response to the world's crises. So we started the Veteran Stress Project more than 10 years ago, and now we've treated over 20,000 people, and so you become much better in your response to social challenges like climate change and PTSD I can't fix gun control, but I can sure offer those PTSD treatments, and then those will produce emotional contagion and make the world a better place. So you actually wind up having it being an agent of social change much more effectively if you are healthy and happy. And you just have to focus, you just choose your inputs, and you choose happy music and happy movies, and you choose light people to be with, and you cut the unhealthy ones from your field of influence. We have an energy field around us. And again, just one negative person can have an effect on our day and then on the days of those people we need. So you just choose your inputs, and then your outputs are also really positive. And who knows how the world might change past that point. But as we become those agents of change around us, as we heal internally, as we affect the world around us, we start to make the world around us a better place in all kinds of ways. And who knows, maybe somebody else is working on a solution for that problem, that we can be supported by they'd be supported by what we're doing and vice versa. So I confidently expect the human race to solve all kinds of challenges, because we have certainly have a whole bunch of them in front of us. But I'm wildly optimistic, Cheryl, about our capacity, the capacity of our abilities. We're also having, you know, one of the reasons, I'm going to write a book about this in time, but later on, but we're also producing all these genetic changes in our bodies, and no species before has had the ability to literally change its gene expression consciously. I can wake up in the morning feeling depressed and anxious and worried and upset and scared, and I can spend 15 or 20 minutes of meditation and completely change my mood and then completely change my gene expression, as a study of 72 genes changing in an hour of EFT showed. There are lots of studies of meditation, too, showing similar biological changes. And now I'm literally changing my gene expression by my consciousness. And this is a remarkable ability, and we've just learned to do this in the last few years. So as we do this, as we trigger gene expression changes in our bodies, as we rewire our brains, no species before us, before human beings, has been able to do what Graham Phillips did in that study and rewire his dentate gyrus 22.8% in 8 weeks. I mean, this is amazing that we have this power. So we are changing our brains and our bodies in every moment by the quality of what we put into our consciousness. And this is going to produce just unprecedented social and environmental and change in every part of society. So that's what I think is we're in the middle of right now.
It really is part of a great awakening, isn't it, Dawson?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So we have a few minutes left, and I was asking you earlier if you could maybe share a brief meditation with us so we can conclude this wonderful, inspiring conversation with a strategy that someone can actually take with them into their lives.
Yeah, and I have a whole bunch of downloadable meditations on my website, mindmeta.com, and they all follow the same seven-step routine. So let me just set a timer over here, Cheryl, so I can time this, how much time we have available. How much time do we have?
We have about, well, we have about 4 minutes.
Okay, so we can
do a little
bit. I'll
leave it up to you to figure
minutes.
That one out.
Yeah. But again, if you want to get have some
maybe
mind,
five. Let's stretch it to five, Dawson.
Five. Okay, good. So go to mindmeta.com for longer ones, but we'll do the best that we can in five. Okay, I'm setting my timer for 5 minutes. Off to the races, in literal sense. Okay. So first of all, if you're in a safe place, close your eyes and put your hands over your heart, and then tap very gently with the fingers of the hand closest to your skin on your heart area, and imagine all stress leaving your body. I now release any and every stress, my mind, my body, and my energy field. I'm now fully present and fully relaxed. Now switch your hands and tap with the other hand. Fully present, fully relaxed. Now just rest your hands gently on your legs and feel the volume of space inside your hands. Feel the volume of space inside your feet. And feel the volume of space between your eyes. Relax your tongue completely on the floor of your mouth. And notice that big empty space between your eyes. Imagine breathing in and out through your heart. And slow your breathing down to 6 seconds per in-breath and 6 seconds per out-breath. Tongue relaxed on the floor of your mouth. Big empty space between your eyes. Breathing in through your heart. 6 seconds. Breathing out through your heart. 6 seconds. And imagine a beam of heart energy flowing from your heart to a person or a place that makes you feel wonderful. Imagine that person or place and this beautiful energy beam flowing from your heart to their heart. Tongue relaxed on the floor of your mouth. Big empty space between your eyes. Beautiful energy beam flowing from your heart to their heart. And now gently bring that energy beam back into your own body, back into your own chest, tongue relaxed on the floor of your mouth, big empty space between your eyes. And now picture the volume of space inside your hands. Picture the volume of space inside your feet. And with the next 2 breaths, gently open your eyes and look around you. Notice the largest object in your environment. Notice the lightest object in your environment. And orient yourself fully and completely back to the here and now. Okay, Cheryl, that was 4 minutes.
That was beautiful. You know, you can go so deep in 4 minutes. It's wonderful. People don't have to take hours to meditate, which I think really can put people off. Or people don't have to just sit there and start focusing on nothing, as often people say. I mean, that strategy of the way you have people focus in the areas moves people deeply into a mindful state quite quickly. And I encourage people to practice this. I encourage people to go to Dawson's website, mindtomatter.com, because he offers so many free meditations to practice. You know, if you never go, you never know. And if people listening want to change their lives, get healthier, have more harmony, more peace, more love, then you have to do something different than what you've been doing. And this is one of the powerful tools to help people make that shift. And I certainly encourage people to do it. It's quick, it's easy, and you'll be amazed how one's life can change. And Dawson, I'm so grateful to you for the wonderful work you're doing, for the ability to create simple, powerful strategies, but also have the science behind it so people can understand and creates the validity of what these ancient wisdoms have taught us. And I love the term democratization of this consciousness. So I am very grateful to you for the wonderful work you're doing, and thank you so much for your time today and for your wisdom. It's so appreciated.
It's been a joy, Cheryl. Thank you for sharing it with your community.
Thank you. And to everyone listening, we've been talking with Dawson Church, author of Mind to Matter, The Astonishing Science of How Your Brain Creates Material Reality, a great book. And go to Mind to Matter to learn how to implement these strategies. And to all of you listening, thank you for joining me again for another journey into possibilities. And until next week, always honor the wisdom of your feminine self. Bye for now.